Yes. Doors Open Toronto is now in its 18th year. We welcome everyone this evening to the keynote presentation on what is Canadian architecture. We'd like to start off this evening by acknowledging that we are on the traditional territory of the Mississaugas of the New Credit First Nation, the Haudenosaunee, the Huron-Wendat, and home to many diverse Indigenous peoples. It's now my pleasure to introduce Gary Sue, an elder from the Mississaugas of New Credit, who will begin with a traditional welcome.
Welcome, and all those other people that we wouldn't have shown you that, but we're the treaty holders of this land, and that's what makes the difference. Because you could be a traditional territory, a good luck bar down here in Toronto, but you don't have a treaty. So that's what makes us, distinguishes us from all the other Aboriginal entities that are here in this land, is that we hold the treaty. And in the future, after 150 years, you would think the people of Canada would know the treaties, but sad to say, they weren't taught them inside of the school system. So I'm looking forward to the next 150 that our students start to learn them inside of the classroom, so that they can see who the people that held this land when the treaties were made. And so, in saying that, I'm going to sing a traditional welcoming song to all of you people from all over wherever you came from. We call this city the Big Smoke. And it's not because, it's the reason to us is because when we would come in our canoes from the east to this way, or from the west to this way, the architecture of the chimneys came up in one vast pile of smoke in the air. And we knew we were getting close to where we were going to join some of our relations and be able to trade with the people of York that were here. So this song is a, and then I'm going to sing you, it is a song that is pre-Confederation. It's old, to say the least. So as you come here to look at us and see the Aboriginal people here. Our doorway of understanding is always open, and all of these doorways are open now for you to learn a little bit more. We always say that every day we feed our body with the food that's been placed here by Mother Earth. And every day we feed our minds with the things that we see and the things that we hear. So you're going to have a good feast here tonight. And when I sing this song, I sing it in the spirit of understanding. So well, for all of you, have a good evening. Enjoy yourself. Miigwech.
Thank you, Elder Sue. Look, as presenting sponsors of Doors Open Toronto, Great Gulf is proud to be able to lend our support and contribute to the exploration of our beautiful city and the architecture that gives expression to its vibrancy. As we celebrate the 150th anniversary of Confederation, the city has witnessed an incredible transformation in its architectural landscape, like some of the most dynamic buildings and iconic designs, many of which are attaining global recognition. Doors Open Toronto is in partnership with the Province of Ontario through the Ontario 150 program with the Province of Ontario, and we'd also like to thank them as a major funder of this evening. Thanks also to music program sponsor TD Bank Group, media partners 680 News, Toronto Star, Omni, City TV, Blog TO, and partners Toronto Society of Architects and First Gulf. Doors Open falls under the City of Toronto's Economic Development Committee. It's now my pleasure to welcome Michael Thompson, Chair of Toronto's Economic Development Committee, Chair of Investment Toronto, a member of the Executive Committee and the Employee and Labor Relations Committee, a board member of Build Toronto, and the City Council representing Ward 37, Scarborough Centre. He is also the co-chair of the Canada 150 External Advisory Committee. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Councillor Michael Thompson.
Thank you very much, Alan. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And Alan, thank you very much for the kind introductions. I suspect that it probably bores most people to hear all these introductions. So I'd like to get right into it. I want to thank you very much for the opportunity to be here. And it is, in fact, with great pride that I stand in front of you representing the City of Toronto. Joining you on top of this amazing, obviously, as you know, it was a soap factory. I'm not sure about you, but I can still smell the soap. Can you smell the soap? Okay, because it's actually pretty strong, and it's actually amazing. And so we are also joined atop this amazing soap factory by some amazing city builders and architects and developers. I'm reminded, actually, of a quote by Henry David Thoreau. The quote is that, if you have built castles in the air, your work need not be lost. That is where they should be. Now, put the foundation under them. And I know this is what is being done by First Gulf, and Alan and Chris and others in the team at Great Gulf are doing this here at the East Harbor. And in other developments, certainly across the City of Toronto and across Canada, and I know in the United States as well. So I want to applaud the work that's being done by Great Gulf and obviously the broader community of city builders for the work that you do in expressing our community's dreams, aspiration in wood, concrete, steel, and of course, my favorite, glass. Without the support, though, ladies and gentlemen, of Great Gulf, our presenting sponsor since 2013, Doors Open would not be the great sensation and great success that it is, in fact, today. So thank you very much, Alan and team, for your support, and also in serving, of course, as master of ceremony tonight. I'd also like to take a moment to welcome two visitors who have joined us from Milwaukee. I'd like to recognize Grace Kovac, and I can't see you because the light is quite bright in my eyes. I think you're at the back there, who is in charge of Doors Open Milwaukee. Would you please stand, Grace? Please stand. Thank you. And Grace has generously brought her politician husband to Toronto. He's an alderman, a similar position, Alderman Nick Kovac. Like to thank, ladies and gentlemen, all of our other key partners in making Doors Open Toronto the huge success that it is today. And as you recall and have been told, and I think many of you know now because you are veterans in terms of attending Door Open events, this is a small initiative that started some time ago and in fact has now grown. I know that people actually wait after the end of Doors Open, let's say in 2016, they can't wait to have Doors Open 2017, and we are actually here. I want to thank the province of Ontario for their sponsorship, as well as our music sponsor, and that's Toronto Dominion Group, and media sponsor 680 News, Toronto Star, Omni City, and also BlogTO. Additionally, the Toronto Society of Architects, our programming partner for this key event, and of course, First Gulf, for letting us hosting this discussion here tonight in this most amazing space. I'd also like to add my personal thanks to members who are working with the City of Toronto in our efforts to bring you Canada 150 celebration. So there are a number of members of the advisory committee that were here. I'd like to thank them for being here. And finally, I want to thank the amazing team led by Pat Tobin, who's the Executive Director of Arts and Cultural Services for the City of Toronto, and all the staff. I'd like to ask you to give them a big round of applause. It's safe to say that I, and I know you are, we're very proud of the festival that in fact we have created together. And we hope that you enjoy all the amazing sanctuary and all the experiences that Doors Open has to offer. And I know that, you know, there are many magical buildings that we tend to pass on a daily basis and so on. Through the efforts of Doors Open, those buildings, you have access to many of those buildings. And for those people who have said to me in the past, you know, Pastor Thompson, it's really, really interesting that I pass a number of buildings during the course of the year and months and so on, and as a result of Doors Open, I have access to go and see those particular facilities and so on. And it is a new revival of experience for our residents to be able to, and of course visitors coming in as well, to see and experience the amazing heritage structures in some cases, and just the amazing design and the creative talent that comes from our men and women who are part of the builders of the city, the architectural and the development community and so on. So I want to just say that the Doors Open offers a tremendous experience and opportunity for you to discover. And in fact, the decade of Canadian architects who have spent a long period of time, and in fact, over 150 years of this exceptional urban design and so on. And we, of course, look forward to another 150 years of the next adventure of buildings and the wonderment for the City of Toronto. And I'm actually hoping to be here to see some of those buildings designed 150 years from now. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for the opportunity to speak with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Councillor Thompson. Today's keynote session falls under the Open Insights Speaker Series, and this is the first of two conversations that we're having exploring the theme of Doors Open Toronto 2017, 15 decades of architecture. We have an impressive array of architects this evening to help us define and understand Canadian architecture and guide our thoughts on the direction for the next 150 years. I'd like to, in a moment, welcome up to the stage Beth Papusta, who will more formally introduce the topic of tonight's session, the presenters, and moderate the segment of the keynote. Beth is a Toronto-based consultant and designer and architecture writer. For the past 4 years, she's headed up the Design Excellence Program at Metrolinx, charting a vision to elevate the quality and customer focus of design across the agency's transit projects. Her city building efforts included shaping complex transit initiatives such as the $6 billion Eglinton Crosstown LRT, the $1 billion East Rail Maintenance Facility in Whitby, and charting a strong design direction for the controversial Davenport Diamond Elevated Guideway and Greenway. She's been involved in numerous projects and competitions that reflect her passion for the urban and cultural landscape of Toronto. And these include parks such as June Colwood Park, H2O Park, and Sugar Beach. She has taught urban design at the University of Waterloo School of Architecture, where she received her Bachelor of Architecture in 1991. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Beth Papusta.
Thank you so much. It's such a privilege to be here. Birthdays like the 150 are always a good opportunity to raise a glass and celebrate what's come before and speculate on the challenges ahead. And that's our privilege here today. In particular, we're here to ponder the question, the Canadian voice in architecture, after 150 years of peace, order, and good government. And this is a relatively recent chapter in the history of a land inscribed by hundreds of years of Indigenous culture. And we here acknowledge the territory to show respect for the Aboriginal people who continue to call this territory home. The architectural celebration of our first 50 years might be characterized by something like transplantation, where we saw cities and towns expand and thrive in the architectural language of diverse immigrant influences. The next 50 were perhaps a more radical departure into an energetic modernism, and we all know the legacy of projects like Expo as a indication of the positive architectural reminder of the sweeping optimism of that period. Our own times are perhaps a little bit more enigmatic and complicated, clouded by the fact that it's always difficult to see the pattern of the maze that we're standing inside. It might be tempting to revert to familiar ideas like landscape as our defining architectural voice, but can we really do this in the face of our increasing urbanization as a nation, where most of our population is clustered like so many iron filings in cities that cling to the 49th parallel. On our best days, we might celebrate our diversity as our defining attribute, with architects situational interpreters of site and programs with sensitive eyes and hands. But architects practice in a world of interwoven design and social justice challenges. How are we celebrating the most vulnerable people? How are we sheltering the most vulnerable people in our society, whether they be our Indigenous citizens, refugees, immigrants, or those who can't afford to live and raise families in our increasingly economically inaccessible cities? How are we responding to the challenges of our increasingly urbanized populations in cities like Toronto, where some 80% of us live in buildings that are not houses? In the context of increasing disparity of wealth, can architecture be a tool of social equity, or is it increasingly the purview of only the wealthiest members of our society? And finally, what role are architects playing in design for a changing climate, to mitigate against it and to adapt to its inevitable consequences? The issue Barack Obama recently called the challenge that will define the contours of this century more dramatically than perhaps all others. But our central question here remains, where are the transcendent architectural moments of resonance and poignancy that speak Canadian values in 2017? Where do we innovate? Where do we excel because of our uniquely Canadian perspective? I'm relieved that I don't have to answer those questions myself. But we're fortunate to have, through the great convening skills of Adam Tom and his team, a group of architects that spans the country and generations and shows a gender diversity that was certainly not the norm at our last big birthday in 1967. Now to our panelists. In the elder statesman category, we're very fortunate to welcome Jack Diamond, whose prolific decades of practice and his natural eloquence afford him a unique vantage point on Canadian architecture. We also welcome mid-career architects at the height of accomplished practices, Pierre Thibault from Quebec, and Valerie Gao of the Toronto-based Gao Hastings, as well as Murray Legg, who brings the bonus perspective of being a Canadian-born architect with a successful practice in Texas, to bring sort of an outsider, insider perspective to our Canadian identity question. Finally, we're going to hear from some of the very strong emerging voices of the younger generation of designers, Susan Scott from Vancouver, and Omar Gandhi, a dual citizen of Toronto and Halifax, who is our speaker, our first speaker tonight. And I will introduce Omar, if you want to get ready to make your way up onto the stage. Omar was born in Toronto and raised in Brampton. He divides his time between homes and practices in Halifax and Toronto. He got his master's degree in 2005 at Dalhousie, going on to work in Toronto for KPMG, Young and Bright Architects, and most recently, McKay Lyons Sweet Apple Architects in Halifax. He started his own design studio in 2010. It's a small 11-person firm doing primarily residential buildings and renovation with a design process that emphasizes landscape and physicality of experience in what the architects themselves call the rise and fall of the land as the essential starting point of design. Omar has quickly emerged as one of the most celebrated emerging architects in the country. I've decided that I'm not going to tell any of the awards that any of these architects have won, with maybe one or two exceptions for each one of them. We'll save probably 5 minutes by doing that, but suffice to say that they are all extremely decorated and accomplished architects with multiple awards. So Omar's best award of his list was being one of Monocle magazine, and you know Monocle as the magazine of expat Tyler Brule. So Omar is one of Canada's 20 most influential Canadians. He's currently also a sessional instructor at Dalhousie University. Welcome, Omar.
Thank you all for being here. This is wonderful. Well, you're smiling at me. Actually, I can't even see your faces. Let me go ahead. So my grandfather actually came to Canada from India in 1956 alone to Montreal, and basically spent the first 4 years of his life here in Canada in the Great Canadian North on the 50th parallel between Flin Flon, Manitoba, and Fort McMurray, monitoring defense systems before coming back to Montreal. 5 years later, my mom and my uncle and my grandmother came and joined him. And there was one thing that was made very clear upon their arrival. It's that we were meant to be here as Canadians and we were meant to fit in. The idea of multiculturalism wasn't really an idea at that point. It was really about why we came here and why we were fitting in. A big journey for me was actually in 2001 when I moved out to the east coast of Canada, where I went to Dalhousie University. An incredible school where, after leaving Brampton, Ontario, it was really my first opportunity to really get a good sense, maybe aside from the noise of Canadian society, to really kind of get a sense of Canadian architecture. It was a place where you'd sit and you'd actually learn how to bang nails into wood, pick up materials with your hand and make things. And it was really when I started my own practice in 2010 where those sort of challenges were brought on me. Moving to small towns like this one in Liverpool, Nova Scotia, where modernism, or Canadian modernism, really was about drawing people in with old materials, the nostalgic quality of wood, and simple forms. But there's also universal themes. So maybe there isn't just a Canadian architecture. There are certain things that are universal. So things like light and texture and sound, the architectural narrative, these are the things that are important in our studio. And then there are things like extreme climate. We have a very, very different situation from east to west in this country, and very different from here in Toronto. And really, how do you relate to both the outdoors, the winter and in the summer? This is a very Canadian thing. There's the idea of natural materials, craft, the beauty of the material in itself. How do you expose that for all that it is? How do you expose that in the most natural way possible to really celebrate the material, the local material that people have been using for centuries? So really, in our own studio, the challenge was, well, how do we do this ourselves? How do we do this? Well, okay, you know, maybe we start with these traditional forms that people love and they know. And maybe it's about slightly torquing and creating slits and bending and moving and really kind of taking that traditional form and those traditional materials and bending them to the client, bending them to the individuality of the user and the individual qualities of that specific site. And then taking that partie, those diagrams, and actually making it into architecture and doing nothing more and nothing less. It really is the embodiment of that diagram in itself. And just the richness of the materials stand out. And this was a process that felt like Canadian architecture to us. This felt like we were going down the right path. And so we applied this to everything we do. This is basically our process. We start with this regional form, and we bend it and torque it and create these slits, and we grow it out of the ground as if it meant to be there. And then there's complexity. Like, how do you kind of create this complexity in the most economical way, using local materials and technologies that people are very comfortable with, like this project in Yarmouth, Nova Scotia, that had a very complex form due to this adaptation process with all of these trusses that were unique in itself. And how do we draw from this narrative, this history of a place in the salt marsh with these haystacks and almost, you know, the idea of creating an architecture that almost mimics this idea of this object in the landscape, like something growing out of the ground itself. But there's also something very Canadian about being a little bit sly, you know? There's this humility, but there's also just this little bit of a wink at the back. And so this cat's eye, this almost like second life that comes out at night with this golden interior using local wood. And then drawing from other references, in Nova Scotia and Newfoundland, they have these really, really simple sheaths that go over the front door, maybe just hold the door open in a windstorm, but also to create a bit of shelter so you can have your smoke. And asking your clients, okay, well, what if we did this on our project? What if we actually did one 25 feet tall, 2 tons, and make it out of Corten steel? And he says yes, and we get to build that, and we get to create this building that stands proud on this little drumlin, tall above the trees, clad in this beautiful wooden jacket with just the natural beauty and texture and uniqueness of that specific wood standing tall. And this golden interior, this yoke almost, on this kind of hard, weather-torn exterior, this light, fun, and really sort of with key aspects of the site in mind, how do we kind of create this duality in architecture? Architecture that we produce is also about being very gentle and thinking about architecture that, well, maybe it actually was there all along, you know? Maybe there's something camouflaged about it, or there's this chameleon-like aspect where it's like this little creature in the landscape that opens and unfolds over time. Or Or maybe it's actually the result of this glacial valley, this glacial movement that left hundreds, thousands of years ago and left the remnants of a wooden building that actually looks like these boulders that have been moving and have broken over time and are exposed. But there's something also very Canadian about being defiant. So maybe it isn't always about fitting in. Maybe it's also about standing there firmly in the ground and staring into that insane Cape Breton wind in the face and cutting into it like a knife. I don't know what Canadian architecture is, but it varies. It varies immensely depending on where you are. And I think that's really the most beautiful thing about Canadian architecture. Thank you very much.
Next up is Pierre Thibault, who is a notable voice and much decorated voice in Quebec and Canadian architecture. He graduated from Laval, founding his own firm in 1988. He has a hands-on and quite poetic approach to making architecture, and his portfolio of work is very strongly magnetized in the realm of culture, performance, and landscape. His prolific works include ephemeral installations of dancing and floating tents, complementing more traditional practice that includes award-winning galleries and theaters, and the project for which he's perhaps best known, the Serene Wood Vessel. That's the Val Notre-Dame Cistercian Abbey. In 1996, he was awarded the Ron Thom Award and the Prix de Rome in architecture the following year. His atelier has 10 employees who have designed almost 60 private residences over the past 15 years, and he's been more recently scaling up to do multiple dwellings such as the Cohabit in Quebec City. Welcome, Pierre.
Thank you, it's a pleasure to be here with you tonight in this special building with a nice discovery for me. I only present my slides, sorry. It's like a travel in Quebec. For me, it's everything starts with our territory. It's all the time a pleasure for me to draw in the landscape. I feel the place, and it's easy for me after that to propose. Sorry, I don't see that. It's why I try to create a better dialogue with the landscape. I like the winter, I like the simplicity of the landscape during the winter, the beauty of the light. The other, I like to also to create a temporary architecture. It's the opportunity to play with different space in the landscape. Realize those installations with nothing. Also, the pleasure to have a temporary installation in the city, like this bench we call Banc de Neige. It reminds us the winter. It's very simple, but they remind us the shape of the snow during the winter time. It's the site of my own countryside. It's the place where my family arrived in the 17th century. It's my house. It's in the back on the site. I'm so impressed when the St. Lawrence River meet the mountain. The pleasure also to have a dialogue with the forest. How the wood is around us and also create this incredible cocoon where it's possible to appreciate the big difference between each season. The power of transformation of the season in our country is unbelievable. I live in Rome, in Paris, and had to commute every month, and I discovered month after month the beauty of our season. It's a part of our life. It's also the pleasure to dialogue with all barns, all the structure. I remember my grandfather built barns, and it was for me when I was young like a real cathedral in wood. Another project are close to a lake. We have also an incredible lake, and I remember one of my uncle have an island on the lake, and it was, I suppose, for me when I was young, like a paradise. We have in our country a lot of paradise as well. I like to travel in our country to discover the site, to reveal the beauty of nature. It's very important to reduce our rhythm. The nature have this power to reduce the speed of our own life. It's why contemplate a landscape like we have, it's a unique opportunity to connect with the real world. Another project very important for me was to design a monastery. I discovered the time at different density. To be in the monastery, we perceive the time could expand, and it's very, very important in our society now to have this ability to modulate the time. We are obsessed about speed, but I think we have to learn with this kind of community how to reconnect with our own rhythm. Walking around this cluster is for me and my team this incredible discovery. Sorry. Yes, we have in this time. In the monastery, it's the best place to cut with our cell phone and to display this. It's incredible. 2 days in the monastery is like 2 weeks in my real life. All the power of the architecture is also to transform the space. It's the ability to transform our relation between the other, but also to transform our perception with time. It's why, like this, for this project, it's also a dialogue with an old structure, how to create this tension between two times. Architecture reveals the beauty of the past and also the beauty of the nature. It's why it's a great. For me, to be an architect is the best practice in our life. All we have the ability to transform the life of many, many people. We create like a choreography of life, and we create a place where it's possible to renew with peace. And that's why to focusing on like a fall or river is create an ability to connect with a different life. Montreal, it's also a place where I like to work in this kind of street, how to convert or transform an old structure to a real habitat. I feel like to recreate the landscape in the city, how to connect also in the city with trees, with river, and like this for this last picture is a new project in the port. How we also create a new structure, then create this dialogue with the old, and then at the same time create a new project. Thank you.
Multidisciplinary and holistic approach to building, which includes architecture, interiors, and graphic design. Valerie graduated from Ryerson with a degree in interior design and then a bachelor's of architecture from UBC in 1994. She co-founded the practice in 2002 after many years with significant firms, Toronto-based KPMG, Austin Smith Lord from the UK, and Chris Bozek Architects in Vancouver. The work of her firm combines a comprehensive understanding of design with a lyrical sense of material, and particularly color and space, leading to projects of intense clarity and finesse. Welcome, Valerie.
Comes to mind for many people about Canadian architecture being up north in the wilderness, and it's our Canadian dream to have a cabin or a cottage of our own. On a remote island in beautiful Georgian Bay, we built the first cross-laminated timber or CLT project in Ontario. Built on a rock outcrop, the building spans across the undulating rock and bridges at one point a large crevice, and the entrance is through this crevice. This planer wood composite product can also be used as floor slabs and wall planes. CLT is in its early days of use in Canada, but so easily manufactured as it's essentially 2x4s laminated together, and something that we have lots of here in Canada. Shapes are cut to suit the design. Openings are pre-cut in factory and assembled with minimal skill. For this project, black spruce was harvested in Chicoutimi, panels engineered in Montreal, shipped by truck and barge to the island, and two cottages were assembled over a couple of weeks. Building north on that same rock, we're currently working on the new Laurentian University Student Center in Sudbury, which is deep in the Canadian Shield. Sorry. The area was completely deforested through years of mining and is now being reforested with new growth birch trees. The building is set into the shield, and the cut rock will be an integral part of the immediate landscape around the structure. Niagara College is situated in the most southerly point of the Niagara Escarpment World Biosphere. We spent a lot of time studying the site prior to beginning the design of our projects, how new buildings can be sited to make their existing buildings work better, to improve the campus experience, and to connect with their natural surroundings. The Canadian Food and Wine Institute maximizes views to the escarpment in an east-west orientation with large south-facing windows. The brick was selected to tie in with the color of the soil and rocks, and the sensory tasting labs provides views of the escarpment, which does so much to flavor the grapes in this region. It's also one of the first colleges to teach the craft of making beer, so how Canadian is that? The city is, however, where most of Canadians live and work, and most of where our designs are required. As a focus of our practice is in education, we renovate many structures built in the 60s and 70s to accommodate baby boomers and are now in need of renewal, repair, and expansion for a new generation, a more diverse population, and an ever-increasing number of us. We worked with Humber College on their initiative to repurpose neighboring buildings at its Lakeshore campus to expand their facilities, create distinct buildings along Lakeshore Boulevard, and create a new and dynamic campus corridor. Humber has been purchasing older buildings and renovating rather than building new, reusing materials and reducing waste, and revitalizing the neighborhood. The Humber Center for Justice Leadership was the first annex building, and the client wanted it to have a really big presence. The existing building was in Mercedes-Benz dealership, and we converted it into a showroom, from a showroom with lots of natural light, into a school for forensics by looking for a solution to reduce light levels. We partially shrouded the building with an undulated, perforated aluminum screen and simultaneously softened the exterior with a lush green living wall, creating a certain mystique through a lack of absolute transparency. The color of ivy changes with the seasons, and in winter, when there are no leaves, maximum light comes through the windows. The infill addition and renovation of Canada's largest culinary school, the George Brown Centre for Hospitality and Culinary Arts on Adelaide, provides a window into the activities within and increases presence for both the college and the culinary school to the city. It transforms a 1980s building into a showcase for innovation in culinary education. So no longer confined to the back of house kitchens, student chefs are part of a culinary display on the street through chopping, slicing, dicing, and the heat of the kitchen, adding an element of theater to the street. Interactive culinary labs are purposely located at street level, separated from the public only by a sheet of glass, and we've often seen students having conversations through it. The Ryerson Architecture Building is the work of Ron Tom, an important Canadian architect, built in the 70s. Buildings of this era are old and tired, and breathing new life into them is typically what we do. The Paul H. Cocker Gallery transforms a former storage area into a presentation space, introducing a crisp white palette to contrast the existing heavy concrete and quarry tile of the existing Brutalist interior. Also at Ryerson, it's a service hub where we transformed a former Brutalist-style cafeteria into a new model for student services and created a light, animated space where students can meet, study, dine, and plug in. And what we didn't realize here was that it would be so popular that it was became a popular venue for gaming clubs after hours. In the rapidly growing suburban environment of Whitby, the Durham College Centre for Food preserves a small plot of agricultural land while also beginning to densify a typical environment found on the peripheries of cities all over Canada. It distinguishes itself from other culinary schools by bringing together culinary, hospitality, and horticulture onto one site. The building set in what was a rural area, carving out a space with fields before all of the farmland in the area is developed. Students gain hands-on experience with a full cycle of food production from field to fork. Horticultural students grow the crops, culinary students cook, and hospitality students serve the food. There's a buzz of cross-disciplinary collaboration in the space. Flexible commercial teaching kitchens allow instructors to customize their labs, and the two-story living wall is unique in that it provides a place to grow herbs for students to harvest before they cook. Highly visible from the 401, the Bistro 67 restaurant provides locally grown, student-prepared, healthy offerings in an environment where you mostly find fast food. This green-certified restaurant serves local food and also offers expansive views over the horticultural fields. It's become a real destination for area residents to dine on thoughtfully prepared, high-quality meals. It all coalesces in this annual highlight, a family-style harvest dinner for 100 people featuring Durham College's crop yield, a really collaborative process for faculty, students, and the community to come together over one evening with food and drink that celebrates gourmet local war food culture while supporting the local economy and local initiatives in a myriad of ways. Thank you.
Before you go, Valerie, I just have one question about the lights. Were they really meant to look like Morel's? Next up, Jack Diamond, a Canadian architect who needs little introduction. He's a statesman, the co-founder of one of Canada's most respected firms, and a fearless advocate for good urbanism and good design in Canada and abroad. Born in South Africa, he received a Bachelor of Architecture degree from Cape Town University in 1956, a Master of Arts in Politics, Philosophy, and Economics from Oxford in 1958, and an architecture degree from UPenn in 1962, where he studied under the master, Louis Kahn. In 64, he immigrated to Canada to direct the Master of Architecture program at U of T, and in 75, he established his own firm today called Diamond Schmidt Architects. Jack's strong civic conscience and his lifetime contribution to Canadian architecture have positively shaped his chosen city, Toronto, with buildings such as the Toronto YMCA, the York University Student Centre, the Richmond Hill Library, Toronto's own Opera House, and this influence literally extends to the international stage with the celebrated New Marinsky Theatre in St. Petersburg, as well as the Harlem Centre for the Arts in Washington, and the Israeli Foreign Ministry, and a little older project, the Jerusalem City Hall. Welcome, Jack.
Question about what is Canadian architecture? Well, architecture is inevitably a reflection of the society in which it builds. And I've chosen five characteristics I think that typify the Canadian character. One is a reverence for our public institutions, of understanding that there's a public and a private benefit that comes from understanding the importance of government, as has been said, that is good law, order, good rather, law and order and good government. There's a belief in diversity, that there's room for the accommodation of such great diversity in our community. There's a respect for the environment and the celebration of the landscape. In the pictures that you've been seeing, they are the institutions that the only ones that break the grid in the city. We have in Toronto, we've got a rigid grid for the most part until you get to the suburbs. But in the city itself, there is Osgoode Hall, there's Queen's Park, there's Old City Hall. They're the buildings that are given pride of place. That speaks so well to the way in which we revere and understand the importance of those buildings. We actually believe that government is part of the solution, not part of the problem, as they do in the United States. We distinguish ourselves in many respects in that way. And this one is at the head of Spadina, now once more instituted by the University of Toronto. All of them are of significant position that we've created for them, not from the natural landscape, but from a man-made configuration. We also have, as I've said, a wonderful modesty and the continuity of community. We do believe that community is important. We believe that public and private are good. That was one of the earliest essays that I had of the Hydro Block, now called Beverly Place, where, in fact, there are staircases, there are front doors, that they, in fact, provide a street continuity. Well, the respect for the landscape, whether it's the floodplains of the prairies or the floodplains of southern Ontario, the buildings can be in harmony with them or in contrast to them, but they take account of that landscape. In this case, it's the Southbrook Winery, and part of that ecological basis is that all of the water that comes off parking lots goes through gabions and reed beds and is filtered before it goes into the conservation district's water drainage system. So that whole aspect of the respect for the environment, the improvement of conditions, also calls for, in my view at least, for a minimalist, the modesty here is exhibited by its minimalism.
taking very few elements and saying that they are both in contrast, and this is often the case with architecture that succeeds, where you are resolving two apparently conflicting requirements, one to be modest and to be part of the background, part of the street, but at times to be also significant in its statement in either harmony or in contrast. This is the Chorus Building on the waterfront, in which its minimalism is apparent, but its power as a piece is used in order to frame views of the landscape. The best part of the open space in the city is the lake. I'm not sure why we've got a great park on the waterfront when it will get built on, but right across from the edge of it, we have an open space that even developers can't build on. That is completely there for keeps, and we should use that. We're using the buildings as gateways. This is the information center at the Botanical Gardens in Hamilton, which the building is in fact a gateway to the Botanical Gardens, but consistent with the notion of using the natural environment to advantage. All of the greenery inside is used actually to filter the air and purify it in a natural manner, because plants themselves do purify air. So this building is a display building, it's an environmentally responsible building, and it is also provides its gateway to the Botanical Gardens. But the landscape sometimes is quite extraordinary, and in Banff, the Banff Center, I found some really interesting things. There are buildings there that face the view with blank walls. Whether those buildings are designed, these are the buildings that we found there. The Lloyd residential building. I found people who, when they looked at this building like we did, said that they never knew that that view existed. The most majestic view in Canada, that the architecture can in fact frame, enhance, and be modest in its own way, but yet provide the drama and the framing of it. That's the building within it, very simple. But it's most important is that this, which is normally a corridor, is made with generosity, because at the conference center, most of the time, the most interesting things that go on are at the coffee break and at the intermission. So outside of the gathering places, there is this well-lit space framing the view and placing for gathering. The La Maison Symphonique in Montreal, we have winter, as has been seen so eloquently in some of the presentations that we've seen to date, much more eloquently than I think that we could possibly accomplish. Here's a building which does stand in a snowy landscape, providing, again, public spaces that are so crucial in the success of public buildings is the social dimension. The architecture is elevated from building to architecture, I think, but in fact it does have that social dimension. And it is a place for art, it's a place for gathering, it's a place for informality. And in the Four Seasons for the Center for the Performing Arts in Toronto, the public spaces virtually capture the cycle. That there are places deliberately there for gathering, for pre-performance talks, and in fact this is the only opera house in North America whose average age year over year is dropping. I put it down to the fact that there are 93 concerts through the winter season where people line up on freezing days at 10 o'clock in the morning to get into spaces where, in fact, they can feel comfortable. The nicest things that anybody ever says to me when they go into the opera house, they say we're as comfortable in it as we are in our living room. The building here has to do one of those things I told you about in resolving two opposing conflicts. It has to be consistent with the block of the city. But it's a public institution that did not have its own space that breaks the grid as it does in Paris with the Garnier. But here it does it with that transparency that gives it a special cachet as well as being consistent with the streetscape. Thank you.
Scott, Susan's a native of Vancouver who got her architecture degree from Dalhousie University in 2000. After working in Montreal and London, she moved to Vancouver to work for James Chen and MGB Architects before establishing Scott and Scott with her partner David within their family home. Scott and Scott launched their practice with an award-winning remote snowboard cabin on Vancouver Island, built with friends using locally felled lumber. Subsequent projects, mostly on shockingly beautiful sites in British Columbia, include cabins in Whistler, Lake Lejeune, houses in Bowen Island, Fino, Squamish, North Vancouver, notable restaurants in downtown Vancouver, and a barn on Pender Island. The firm's design sensibility shows a strong sense of simple detailing, expressive materials, with a custom design of very tactile things like furniture, lighting fixtures, and architectural hardware, a big part of what distinguishes their practice. Susan told us last night over snacks that she, had she not become an architect, she would have become a contractor. And this implicit love of making things shows through very clearly in her work. Welcome, Susan.
A small architecture firm. We practice out on throughout the West Coast, mainly in British Columbia, but also expanded to Oregon and California. For us, Canadian architecture seems focused in the bigger cities, and like the rest of the world, these cities are more urban and global rather than specifically Canadian. We focus a lot on the materials and locally sourced and sustainable materials. This is one of our first projects. We built it together with a bunch of friends on the northern end of Vancouver Island. It's a rugged and wild terrain and free of most of the municipal zoning constraints. The limitation here was that the cabin had to be 1,000 square feet and there was no mechanical excavation allowed. All the materials are locally sourced, mainly Western Red Cedar and Douglas Fir. It allows us to monitor the weathering of the material over time. And as you can see in this image, the cedar has grayed out. However, the cedar under the entry there maintains the warmth and the color of the original wood. The cabin is also beyond cell phone zone, which is a very important part of our young practice. Not far from the cabin is a quarry up above the Hisnet Inlet on the west coast of Vancouver Island. We traveled there from our cabin. It's not very far physically, but it's a 6-hour drive down a long dirt road. And we went there to source a block of marble that was installed in this renovation to a 1950s post and beam house. It's a monolithic slab sink, and we just refreshed and replaced most of the added adornment that was added over time into this old structure. The floor-to-ceiling height there is 7 feet high, and that might have been overlooked by a lot of others and torn down. This is an image of Highland Valley Mine in the center of British Columbia. It is the largest open-pit copper mine in Canada. And it came to our attention that this old pump house structure was available for purchase. I think it cost $1. But we had to dismantle it. We refurbished it in a shop in Kamloops and then re-erected the structure up on top of, right beside a lake nearby Lac Lejeune. During the construction, all the trees on the site were infested with a pine beetle, and we took them all down and used them as the interior cladding. We haven't totally given up on the city, and we find that most of the opportunities there, though, lie in restaurants where younger, perhaps more ambitious clients are able to offer us a different opportunity and are forced to invest in design to make their business successful. This project is started as a food truck, so we used utilitarian materials like the moving blankets and denim insulation to complement the food that's served. We find in Canada there's a similarity between the work of the architect and the work of the chef. We're both trying to source local and sustainable materials and bring them together in beautiful and perhaps unexpected ways. This is a small new restaurant in Kitsilano, and the cedar cabinets surround the surface and provide needed storage for the restaurant. And the tabletops are also sourced from the same marble quarry that was shown before. One problem with bringing things supplying locally is those chairs came from Portugal in 3 weeks, and the local tabletops took over 3 months to arrive. We are also finding a result of the high price of Vancouver real estate. A lot of people are moving out of the city. This is going to be the future home of a young couple who have moved to the outskirts of Victoria, and it allows them to work remotely and harvest asparagus at the same time. We spend a lot of time going out to mills and fabricators. This is a shake and shingle mill north of Campbell River. They supply most of their product directly overseas to Russia and Japan, but we approach them directly, and they were able to provide shakes for this house in Tofino. It was deliberately designed without overhangs or eaves, so that the untreated shingles could weather uniformly over the course of the year. And we're looking forward to going back this summer to see if that's happened and it's back in the rainforest. We also use those same shakes, or shingles actually, on this A-frame cabin in Whistler. It's 1,800 square feet, much smaller than most of the cabins that are built in Whistler. But with a small footprint, it allowed the clients to invest in durability of construction and quality of material. This one is my house. We lived here for 8 years before we were able to do anything with it. Perhaps that's one thing in Canadian architecture too, is patience. We now live on the upper floor in the attic, and we've transformed the basement main floor that used to be a corner store into our studio and office. It provides a complicated work-life balance, but it works well for our family and allows us to maintain the consistent use of the building that was originally built in 1910. These are two of our upcoming projects that will be completed. We'll start construction this summer, and for us they summarize many of our thoughts on Canadian architecture. They're both small. They both will use local materials and construction methods, and both of them will actually be built by hand by the owners. And for us, Canada is a huge country. We have vast resources, and perhaps we should consider Canadian architecture as using these resources sustainably and considering the scale of our projects responsibly. Thank you very much.
Practices both architecture and landscape architecture in Austin, Texas. After studying at U of T for 2 years, he graduated from Cooper Union in New York. His professional achievements include Young Architect Awards from the AIA and more than 20 design awards. Under his architecture hat, he's the principal of Murray Lake Architecture, a firm that does diverse institutional work, performing arts buildings, centers for the homeless, and schools, as well as a number of subtly sculptural and houses with strong connections to landscape. Murray's also the co-founder of Lewis Leg, an interdisciplinary collaborative with his sister, the New York-based visual artist Andrea Leg, and his wife, filmmaker Deborah Lewis. Their work is focused on large-scale installations, public art, and landscape design. I hope Murray shares this work with us. There's a real playful conceptual quality to this work, from the biomimicry of a garden maze based on the shape of a fingerprint, to canopies inspired by the structures of clouds. And there's even one project in there that makes dreaded garden gnomes look amazing. I hope you get that, Murray. Welcome.
In Whiteville, Ontario, which is about 40 kilometers from here. This is an image of it from 1877, which doesn't really seem that long ago, 140 years. The village is sited on the banks of the prehistoric Lake Iroquois, which is 13,000 years old. The landscape of southern Ontario was formed through the rush of meltwater. It was moving under the ice and the glaciers as they moved northward. The flow between the ice sheet and the land created a family of unique landforms. You can see these landforms in the Drumlin Field southeast of Owen Sound. Although these happened 13,000 years ago, their fluid shapes give them the feeling that they've just been made. Roundup was our first project for the Jardin de Matisse in Gaspé. It is a field of 9 landforms in a grid, each about 2 meters tall, sort of a human scale. You can move in and around them. Their anthropomorphic quality gives them the impression that they're moving through the forest together. They were created from dirt, held together with sod and truck strapping. At first, they all were created identically, but over time, they begin to kind of erode and change, taking on their own shape and personality over time. One of our interests is in how we can include and incorporate unmanaged wild spaces in our work. So as an experiment, we let Roundup go to seed and become overgrown. These overgrown spaces are very difficult to occupy, so the following year we introduced a pathway through it. This is a nature trail in the form of a balance beam, which turned moving through the bramble into a kind of sport with some danger. Right. We're currently working on a project in San Diego. This is for the San Diego International Airport. Here, the zigzag of pathways are sloped walkways that allow people to move around a drumlin-shaped landform. It's a park that lifts people off the ground so that they can see over the security fencing to watch planes land at the airport. This hydrodynamic landform has its own ridge line, which forms a horizon. The main pathway follows the horizon line up to a lawn, which is shearing off the park and is cantilevered over the roadway. Won't touch this. More loosely defined, fluid shapes were used to develop this park pavilion for the city of Dallas. Here, the undulating surface creates a ceiling of varying depth. The roof is transparent, so light passes through it, creating a gradation of light and shade, lighter in the thinner areas and thicker, light darker in the thicker areas. The building is made of layers of white powder-coated steel plates that are hung from the structure above. They actually conceal the structure. And their appearance changes depending on the light conditions, sometimes appearing very solid, monolithic, other times appearing very transparent. On a sunny day, the steel plates, they have a kind of reflectivity to them, so they reflect into one another, and it gives it kind of shine, they're kind of shiny, it gives it the impression that the plates have kind of dissolved together. This is an elusive quality where the changing light and your position affects the building's appearance. I also like the idea of bringing a snowdrift to Dallas. Here, the drumlin shape is clearest in this pool house roof, which forms a ragged, overgrown hill echoing the surrounding hills of the Box Canyon where it's sited. These are sections through it. It's designed to look like it's detaching from the building, floating. The interior, by contrast, is hollow. It's a smooth, shiny vault, like the roof of a mouth. Where the outside is rough and wild, the interior is streamlined, recalling boat construction. ceiling is constructed in the same way a cedar strip canoe is, using thin one-inch strips of cedar that have a slight tonguey groove to them. Building a canoe, you start at the gunwales and you work your way around the body of the canoe to the keel line. Here we started at the eave, working our way around to the eave, the cedar conforming to the compound, curving shape. Another interest of ours is in the picturesque and romantic. Here, an image of an object on a lake. You get the comfort from the recognition of something familiar in the landscape, familiar in a wild setting, but at the same time, there's a kind of isolation from its fragility. For this non-denominational chapel outside of Austin, there's the idea of creating a building which is part of the forest. It's sited on in a clearing on a lake. It's built using a hybrid of log and stick frame construction. The building uses local cedar from a sawmill nearby, which is sawn on two sides for the lower members, but as you move upwards, they become more refined. So the upper members are sawn 2x4s, which are cantilevered and don't touch each other, so they're free to move in the breeze. And when this happens, a sudden connection with the forest is made. The design of the building starts with a frame profile of a simple chapel building, the way a child might draw a frame profile, but then it collapses in on itself and it changes. So as a non-denominational chapel, there's the idea that it could change or that it is changing. We're at an interesting time right now with the potential for manufactured wood products and digital fabrication. For this chapel, to the patron saint of writing, St. Francis de Sales, we're using a set of basic profiled laminated wood products that are stacked horizontally like log construction in layers and shifted. The result is a kind of cursive looping structure. The wooden components were designed to have registration holes in them to allow them to be stacked and shifted incrementally, so you get this kind of shifting back and forth and leaning on each other. The idea here is sort of like somebody drawing or warming up a pen where they're doodling and creating a loop without actually writing anything. The final project I wanted to show was our last project for the Jardin de Matisse called Fractal Garden. This is a set of 21 planters on wheels that can be reconfigured in hundreds of different arrangements. And the idea here was the kind of absurd attempt to create something that had no specific identity or no specific style, which is really kind of an impossible task because it, no matter what form it takes, it retains its identity as a puzzle. Thank you.
Collection of speakers and thoughts about what is like a Canadian architecture. The Toronto Society of Architects has played an integral role in organizing this forum, so I'd like to welcome to the podium Maria Denigre. She is board chair of the Toronto Society of Architects, to thank our panelists and moderator. Maria.
Another aspect, which you may not know, is that anyone can join the Toronto Society of Architects. You do not need to be an architect or an urban designer or a planner. You can be an enthusiast and a local resident who's just really passionate about Toronto. So if you were inspired, as I was, by the presentation tonight, I do encourage you to take a look at our website and see what other great events we have planned for you this year. my role here, I guess, tonight is to really say thank you, and there's lots of thank yous. So first and foremost, I do want to thank the City of Toronto for giving us this opportunity to partner with them. We have been engaged in Doors Open for the last few years. This is, I think, the third iteration of a discussion panel discussion and presentation, which we have offered the public. As well, we have a series of walking tours over the weekend, which we encourage you all to participate. And also, several architects have opened their doors to the public on Sunday. So if you are interested to see and get a glimpse of the work behind the scenes, we encourage you to visit our studio tours as well. Second, I'd like to thank the panelists for an incredible set of presentations. We have journeyed across our amazing country, and I think have all been really inspired. I think a recurring theme which we have seen tonight is the important role that the Canadian landscape plays in a lot of our work. Next, I'd like to also thank Beth Capusta for a very compelling introduction and a framing of the discussion. And also a couple of members of our executive, which have been instrumental in working with the city, Adam and Barbara. I think you really do deserve a round of applause for a great job. Thank you. Okay, so finally, I would like to invite the panelists to come back up to the stage. We will have a Q&A session, which will be moderated by Beth. So please ask questions and participate in this amazing discussion. Thank you.
Architects, because it was my responsibility to kind of understand their work more deeply through their websites and through their words and their projects, was that they share an affinity, and this may say a lot about Adam, who chose them, but they all have incredible drawing hands. And I think there's something about, within the architectural process, the idea of exploring the nature of a site through drawing, that I'd like to hear our panelists talk a little bit more about. Pierre, you do those beautiful watercolors, and there's clearly such a love of landscape in your drawings. Do you want to talk about that a bit?
It's very important to take time and decide. It's difficult to recreate in our studio the beauty of the sign. On the side, my hand is like she started to draw without my head. It's like a physical connection. The drawing offers us this possibility to. It's not like to take a picture. It's 1 second. To draw, we have to observe with a lot of attention. Sometimes for one drawing, we take an hour just to observe the main line of the landscape, what is very important, and it's incredible. After a day to draw on the side, we feel we have the side in our body. It's completely different than to take a picture. It's why I start to design on the side with the drawing.
I don't believe that you see anything until you draw it. And one of the things that I find difficult with the magnificent capabilities of the computer, they look too cooked, too soon. They look completed as a drawing. They're a fantastic discipline, but there's nothing that beats a soft pencil sketch with speed for feedback, for conceptualization. At least I don't, and it might be my age, but the fact of the matter is that the schematic drawing, the language that you use for the pencil and paper, gives you a faster conceptualization than any computer could ever do. The feedback is immediate. You see things that you did not have in your mind when you began drawing. It's revealing, and it is enormously economic. Yes, because it doesn't have the discipline of dimension, it doesn't have the discipline of structure, which is what the computer can then test you on. But the importance of drawing, for me, cannot be overemphasized. And I happen to like watercolor paintings and drawings. The fact of the matter is that it's a very different technique from representing something else in a painting or a drawing. You actually are creating something that's absolutely new. And nothing beats drawing with a hand and piece of paper.
Do any of our emerging generation of architects want to speak to that?
Yeah, I think that, you know, there's a lot of emphasis on the drawing that you end up seeing at the end. And I think that what gets lost is the dozens, if not hundreds, of drawings that take place during that process. So I think really drawing is the process itself. That's wonderful. And it's, I think it's part of the joy of our profession and the process of design. It's really thinking and feeling that pencil in your hand and allowing it to weigh heavier or lighter on that piece of paper to emphasize different ideas. When I teach, I actually encourage students to use the fattest, like kindergarten pencil that they can find, so that they don't actually get lost in the lines themselves, but actually really use their arm and their hand to as almost a means to think on paper, to go through paper. So I think that's something that gets lost in schools nowadays, but there are certain places where it's still very important. I think that we're going to see how that loss of process is going to affect the architecture that we see.
For me, I'm actually a terrible hand drawer, but very good at tracing over computerized drawings, and usually that's one of the techniques we use. For us, though, our focus is on the physical model. It's something we enjoy doing, and that's where we excel at using our hands rather than so much drawing. We do very little computer rendering. It takes up a lot of time for us, and we find it inevitably leads to disappointment from a client perspective, because the end building is never quite as perfect as what you see.
For us, we do a combination of computer drawing and hand drawing. It's a lot of printing out and drawing over again. But what we found a lot of success with is photography, taking photographs and layering on top of that and doing enhanced sketches so that you're thinking about the environment that the design and the building is going to, and it's much more immediate, having that sort of interface and collage between two-dimensional and three-dimensional drawing technique.
Yeah. I think the question of drawing, I think, is such an interesting question. I mean, I'm of the generation where the first jobs I had coming out of school were you were drawing by hand. I mean, you're doing construction drawings by hand. Now there are, unless you learn hand drawing in architecture schools, some architecture schools teach them, some are more heavily weighted to digital tools. Some of the people that we get coming in the office actually have no skills whatsoever drawing by hand. I remember one of the first job interviews I had in New York, the architect sat me down and had me like hand letter to test the alphabet, because you could sort of tell your skill as a draftsman by your lettering. The one thing I wanted to say about hand drawing that I think is interesting, because I do, we really embrace all the digital tools, we love the digital tools, but being a father, having a kid that went through Montessori education, where there is this kind of crazy idea, they learn cursive is really important, which is kind of like a lost art, but the idea there, which I think is really profound, is that you're learning an abstract concept, the concept of an A, but you're connecting with a physical gesture in space. And I think that that relationship of like body movement and connecting with a conceptual idea, I think there's something really profound there that relates to why hand drawing and architecture is so important. Physical gesture of moving in space while you're creating, kind of imagining and conceptualizing.
For any of you in the audience who are thinking of becoming clients with a Canadian architect, going through that process of watching a building come to life through drawings and through a kind of tangible manifestation of the imagination is one of the great learning experiences that you will ever have. With that, I will hand the questions over to the audience. Do we have mics set up? What is our AV situation? Okay, so there are mics in the audience, so feel free to either direct a question at one of our panelists or to ask a broad question of all of them.
Just on the topic, again, of process, is there, in your opinion, a particular Canadian process in terms of your collaborations with people and working relationships?
For us, most of our clients are remote. They're distance from us, so our collaboration is done through email and telephone or some other form of communication. And I think the process for us is we like to try and nail it the first time to really get things going, because most people have not got the patience to wait. They're paying their property taxes or they're paying rent somewhere else. And for us, I think it's speed and really trying to understand what those clients want and how to interpret that and clarify that for them through the drawings. We like to think we're getting better at it, but every time it's an unexpected discovery, depending on the client and the location.
In terms of the work that we do, we collaborate a lot with students and student groups and the different players at colleges and universities. And for us, it's all about, and I think this is very Canadian, is asking people what it is that what it is that they would like to see within their spaces and having a very sort of an open conversation and a dialogue to find out what it is that are the aspirations of various groups. And so we will do sort of larger electronic surveys of many students, the student population, and workshops, and engaging the different groups with bingo exercises or discussions and just trying to get the opinions of many people involved in the design of our buildings.
While I have the mic, just a clarification in terms of the drawing. It's very different when you're sketching design ideas freehand. Drawing the partie is an enormous economy, the language to that, versus the actual drafting component of it. Both allow you to edit the skis of the very small sketch. You can develop three approaches to a problem and begin to analyze them with huge speed. But in terms of collaboration, I think the closest other professional field is a movie. I look at the credits at the end of movies. The director has this enormous team, besides the cameraman or woman who plays a huge role. There is also the producer, that is the financier and organizer. then there are a host of other people besides the actors. And in architecture, it starts with a very small team, I found, that to discuss the options and discuss those tiny sketches and approaches, looking at the partee. But then there are a host of consultants that are critical inputs into shaping what happens. They're not there to prop it up later on a finished drawing. They are there actually to influence it. And if you take, for example, in a performing arts facility, what I call the troika, the acoustician, the theater consultant, and the architect, if they're not informing one another with the most powerful inputs, you don't have a good result. There's all the rest of it that requires the kind of construction of a particular and specialized kind, whether it's a laboratory or it's a hospital. But the fact of the matter is that there are dozens of inputs of a professional kind that have to be integrated at their highest level. And it's that truth that the more inputs, the better the output. And the trick of the architect is to get the best out of those. It's like a good interlocutor that brings out in conversation all of the nuances of a subject. So very often we are playing the role of interlocutor, of being testing, questioning, finding challenging of how each one of these inputs, whether it's an engineer of one kind, whether it's the cost consultant, plays a very important role in design, because all of the resource allocation is value-laden. Where you put the resources, where the emphasis should be. I mean, Mozart or Beethoven writing a requiem would not use a comical theme. It's that thematic tone that comes out of the nuanced approach, emphasis of the most enormous and creative inputs. That collaboration is of vital consequence to the outcome.
I was just going to respond to the question about collaboration. I feel, in particular, when you're doing wood frame construction, at least for my studio, and this probably stems from, you know, the education that I was given at Dalhousie, but really the collaboration with the builder themselves, and kind of learning, you know, some of these age-old skills that have been passed down. For me, you know, not being from out east, and moving out there, and you know, certainly knowing how to draw certain things, you know, the act of actually putting materials together and understanding how materials work, we really rely on that collaboration in particular. And I was actually at Laurentian University a few months ago to give a lecture, and saw that it's actually an integral part of their curriculum that they learn from the First Nations elders, understanding materials and you know, traditional methods of construction. And I thought that that was, you know, about as Canadian as it gets.
I can't see past this light, so if there are other questions.
Hi, so I'm a student and I'm not from Canada, but all the architecture I really know is the Canadian flavor, because from a developing nation, we don't have our own architecture schools, and many of our largest projects, far from being modest or you know, respecting the private and the public, they do tend to come from an anonymous designer, and there's no input from the public. And the local architecture associations, there's limits on how much they can even advocate or advertise for themselves, because there is limits on self-promotion. Do you guys have advice for how the discourse and the lovely, you know, comparisons that have led you to define Canadian architecture as famed tentacle landscape. How do you export that without, you know, this ability for public discourse and without any sort of local schools there to define their own problems and maybe try to fix them themselves the same way you guys have been able to do that? That's the question.
So to understand the question correctly, you're talking about like how as architects you can engage a larger community
outside of Canada.
Oh, outside of Canada, I see. Right.
As someone who's an immigrant,
right?
But just there's fitting in, but also maintaining that cultural uniqueness.
Right.
Do I forget about the contrast of what I am learning here and the difficulty of even implementing it, where I do come from?
Oh, I see.
Know, how do I...
Like exporting that?
Yes, how do I export that?
Yes, like exporting that. Maybe I can, you know, speak to that. I'd say, like, I do live in a place like Austin, Texas, which is fundamentally like a kind of a terminally democratic city. So it's very similar in a way to my experience of working with community kind of like levels and complexity of community input in Austin is like very, very sophisticated. So, I mean, there's a kind of like a comparison there culturally. But I do think it's like a cultural condition. You know, with social democracy, typically there is greater degree of input in community input in terms of the civic direction in cities and planning. That unfortunately architecture, I mean, one of the challenges as an architect is that we've been kind of marginalized and kind of pulled out of that process where the profession is kind of siloed. So a lot of the work that goes into planning and engaging communities relies on the work of planners, and architects are often kind of brought in to provide their work, again, as a kind of singular object when a lot of those kind of fundamental decisions have been made. I'm not sure if I answered the question.
Another question?
I have a question. As someone who's both licensed in the U.S. and Canada. Curious and very interested in Great Lakes, the Great Lakes region. Just curious to know if, since you're working in Toronto and Vancouver, you're close to border. I just wonder if you have clients that are on the U.S. and Canadian side, and if you have to adjust, and we're talking about Canadian architecture today, I see the border as a soft condition, and I wonder if you find that you adjust as you work with maybe an American client. Anyone bilingual?
We've started a few projects in California and Oregon, and I guess maybe it's more of a West Coast connection rather than a U.S.-Canadian separation we find there. We haven't adjusted our approach or our design sense. I think there is perhaps on the West Coast more of a commonality that I can't speak to the Great Lakes region across that way, but for us, the West Coast modernism is expands beyond the borders, and we don't see a lot of difference there.
Okay, I think we've got time for one more question, maybe two if they're fast ones.
I'm curious about, again, this picking up the thread of landscape. You're an incredibly diverse group. You have very different educational backgrounds, and you practice in very different parts of the country, and in some cases also in the United States. But landscape was a consistent theme through, if not all the presentations, at least most of them. And I'm very curious to hear what influences you in that regard. Is that something that your clients are very interested in? Is it something that you come from your own background, perhaps going to cottages in Muskoka or in the Rockies? Or is this part of just generally of our cultural interest and something that you see a lot in paintings and sculpture and art and in film and novels?
I think it's really, it comes down to a way that you decide to think about architecture and what you think is important, and maybe trying to find meaning in a particular work. I think, you know, in that search for whether it's a Canadian architecture or an architecture that certainly belongs in a place, the landscape is certainly kind of, not just the landscape, but climate in general and context. So the sun, you know, the direction of the wind, you know, views, topography. These are things that are always sort of universally kind of the first steps of what we look at as an architect. And I think that's kind of a universal approach. It just so happens in our country we have such dramatic landscapes that you know, differentiate kind of all of our work.
It's the territory is very, very important in my work. It's why the first step is to be there. It's like the collaboration start with very often with a dinner on the side. We create like a new family, and the landscape is like a part of the family. Sometimes we have to ask a question to the landscape. What is good for you? That's why we like to work also with the temporary installation. Sometimes it's like a laboratory. It's like start a discussion with form on the side, and it's why. And the same project is not the same if we move from one landscape to another. It's why our strategy is to find the most beautiful form on the landscape to create a nice dialogue. It's why. But the first thing is to understand this landscape and to minimize our work on this side. It's my way.
Obviously a French thing, so and I'll tell you why. Why did Napoleon win all his battles? He walked the battlefield before anybody else.
I wanted to add something. I mean, I think that's an interesting question. Pierre and I were actually just talking about, he had visited Texas for the first time, right, in November, and had driven to Marfa from Dallas, and of course it's an 8-hour drive, driving 150 miles an hour. But there are certain kind of like interesting parallels between Canada and the American Southwest. You have these kind of vast, uncharted, uninhabited regions. It's a very extreme landscape. But there are some fundamental differences. When I first moved down there, driving through those landscapes, you become aware that you're on a very fine publicly owned thread, which is the road, and surrounded by privately owned land. Like, as far as the eye could see, would be ranch land owned by a single family. And that's a very different kind of perspective than the Canadian perspective, where the land is like collectively owned crown land, where you can kind of pull your car over on the side of the road and hike through the woods and camp in the woods. And I think that is something that I think is really a kind of attitude towards the wilderness and towards the land that is like fundamentally kind of Canadian phenomenon, fundamentally kind of cultural conditions, very different than the American notion where property is owned, you know, individually.
For us, we've built our practice primarily starting out with interior renovations and sort of working out. But what we found in terms of our landscape is that we've started taking a look at how to work with rock. And in the first slides that I'd shown of the CLT houses in our cottages in Puno Barrel, it was really about sort of perching on top of the rock. And then now we're taking a look at Laurentian University. It's how to build deep into it and using rock potentially as a foundation and building deeper into it. And so that's the kinds of things that we're working with now in terms of landscape.
Last word?
Sure.
I think for us, we have a lot of projects on vast landscapes where the first decision about where are we going to put the building is so exciting and refreshing compared to perhaps a single family house in the city where you're very, it's very constrained, very controlled, and you don't really get to consider those views or the scale or the height or the feeling of the house on that landscape. And for us, that's really the most exciting part and inspiring about the Canadian landscape is that it is so so varied and so dramatic that being able to go out there and look at the opportunities is really, I think, the most exciting part about our session.
Thank you very much for being here tonight with us, and thank you to all of our panelists for an incredibly rich conversation.
Thank you. I won't keep you long. I think I stand between you and the bar. I don't think this bar is opening, but there is a bar open somewhere. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes the first of our talks in this weekend's Open Insight series. Thank you for coming, and we hope to see you at the second talk on Sunday on the topic of Missing in Action, Where Are All the Women Architects? For the next 2 days, there will be a series of activities that will interest everyone. Exciting venues, concerts, film projections, family activities, other special programming. So please visit toronto.ca/doorsopen for details. Please share your photos, feedback, and excitement on this website, and also on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram pages. We'd like to thank our partners, the Province of Ontario, through the Ontario 150 program, our music program sponsor, TD Bank Group, media partners, 680 News, Toronto Star, Omni, City TV, Blog TO, and our partners, Toronto Society of Architects, and First Golf. And lastly, to plug one other event, later this year, in September, from September 28th to October 8th, in this location at East Harbor, this will become the venue for the inaugural edition of EDIT, which is Expo for Design, Innovation, and Technology. It's produced by the Design Exchange, and it is a partnership with the United Nations Development Program and Signature Ontario 150 event. It is a Signature 150 event, and it envisions a world transformed by unparalleled design solutions through an array of curated exhibits, compelling talks, and interactive experiences. EDIT is generously supported by the City of Toronto and will draw global attention to our city's remarkable leadership in the areas of design, innovation, and technology. So we hope to see many of you over the weekend and at coming events this fall. So thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of your evening and the weekend. Thank you.